It's kind of interesting, the names of these two fellows. We have Rehoboam, we have Jeroboam. What does Rehoboam mean? It means the people are enlarged. That is, the population has increased. But that's very ironic, because Israel had already reached the high point of their population. The numbers, that is. They had reached the acme of political power under Solomon. And under Rehoboam the weak, the indecisive, they're actually declining. So, nice try. It's too bad his name couldn't be fulfilled. But the people are not being enlarged. And then the name of Jeroboam, the people contend. They contend with God, fundamentally. Jeroboam contends with Rehoboam. So, we can see the split, the wedge that's dividing Israel, ripping it into two, which will ultimately lead to two separate exiles. The north will fall first because of the sin of Jeroboam, son of Nebat, also because of his sons. They'll be led into captivity by the Assyrians in the 8th century BC. Judah in the south will hang on a little bit longer, and they'll be ultimately taken into captivity by the Babylonians in the 6th century BC. Okay, it's time to conclude, and then let's talk about what we learn about God. There are two poles of leadership. One is permissive. It's, I suppose, it thinks of itself as being creative. It's liberal, in a way. The other pole is conservative. It's restrictive. Rehoboam tries that restrictive, ultra-conservative approach. You know, you think my father was tough. Solomon was wimpy compared to me. And he throws around his muscle, though he doesn't really even have that much muscle. He's rejected. That's the one pole. You have Jeroboam. He's creative. He's liberal. He's an opportunist. He wants power. And he says to the tribes, it's really too much. This old system, the Levitical system, that's a bit extreme, don't you think? Here's an alternative. Just go to Dan, go to Bethel. Anyone can be a priest. We'll have our own festival. We'll have a good time. Although they're at opposite ends of the pole, one being very restrictive, one very permissive, both of them were actually trying to maintain control. This is not a political commentary, but if I were going to get into it, I would argue that liberals, conservatives alike, one thing they have in common is they all want control. And they're at opposite ends of the spectrum. Most leaders err on one side or the other. Now, what's my personality type? What's my tendency? Speaking for myself, it's got to be the more controlling. The farther back I remember, the more controlling I seem to have been. If I think back a few years, I can see some changes, some reforms. I go back a bit, a few years further, and I think, ooh, that probably wasn't the way to handle it. I go back a few years more, and I cringe, and I go back 15 or 20 years, and I start to wince, and I go back farther. And it's not that God doesn't use it. God was working through Rehoboam. God works through all these kings we may look at. But I think it just goes along with age. The older you are, normally the gentler you become. I hope I'm mellowing. But that means the converse is that when we rewind the hands of the clock, as farther back we go, the more we act out of insecurity and we can be controlling. Well, that's my type. That means I've got to fight this. How about you? Which pole do you tend towards? Are you a very permissive leader? Are you a very controlling leader? Or I guess if you're like Jesus Christ, you'd have the right balance. That's a tough act to follow. Which pole do you tend towards? And you may say, well, Douglas, I'm not a leader, so it doesn't apply to me. Well, then just apply it to personality, because we all we gravitate one way or the other. How can we find the balance? Well, I've already suggested, let's look at the leadership style of Jesus. We've got to study God's Word. We've got to learn from history. History of Israel and from church history. And yes, we should collaborate with different people, but we've got to listen to the older folks, not just the young guns. Often, wisdom is found in the aged. And last, what do we learn about God? Well, there are three lessons that emerge. Maybe you can find some more. First, God knows what will happen. He knows all things. Now, through the prophet, two prophets we actually looked at in this lesson, it's clear he knows the future. He knew about Jeroboam's rebellion against the line of Solomon. He knew about Rehoboam's immaturity and his harshness, and even the civil war that would follow. And he knew that Rehoboam would eventually mellow out, and that Jeroboam would lead the people to the precipice. But God's foreknowledge in no way removes our responsibility. He knows all things, but that doesn't take away our responsibility. Number two, as with Isaac and Ishmael, Jacob and Esau, well, so it is with Judah and Israel. So it is with Rehoboam and Jeroboam. God was still sovereign. He worked his mysterious will. God is working through these events. But the fact that he does so never vindicates evil or condones compromise. The fact that God is working through a number of unspiritual individuals and nations and movements throughout history and throughout biblical history does not mean that what they do is absolutely right. In fact, it could be absolutely wrong, but still God would be moving. And third, there are extremes to be avoided in leadership. God's word often shows us the fruits of ungodly philosophies of leadership. And with that in mind, the next podcast will focus on Ahab and Jezebel.